Now, I think the only reason this context-free language is a study is because of their applications. Natural languages tend to have context-free structure, and it just seems to be the way our mind works. It tends to organize languages in context-free. I guess children, when they're learning language, they sort of their inner thoughts organize things that way. And it's probably because context-free languages correspond to tree structure, you'll see, which is a hierarchical structure, and that's the way we tend to think about things in a hierarchical manner. Something has subparts, and the parts have subparts, and so on. Room has chairs, and the chairs have parts, or whatever. Anyway, and context-free languages are recognized by an automaton called a pushdown automaton, which is like a finite automaton. And one reason it's helpful to study finite automata is because the same kind of structures are found in more complicated automata. And once you understand finite automata, it helps you understand pushdown automata, Turing machines, other kinds of automata you may encounter. So Markov process, whatever they're called. So, and pushdown automata would like to find an automaton, but they have an infinite amount of memory that they can access, but only in the last and the first object. So they have this memory, and they can push stuff onto a stack, keep pushing, and they can pop it. But they cannot look inside the stack. They can only look at the top of the stack. And once they look at the top of the stack, it disappears. Or they can write on the top of the stack, push something on the top of it. It's sort of a peculiar model. And again, the only reason I think it's mentioned is because it's related to context-free languages, which have applications. Not only to human language, but computer languages are very close to context-free language. Now, there's a debate about some computer languages, whether they're really context-free languages or not. But you'll see later that these debates are not some minor aspects of these languages. And for the most part, they're context-free. There are some things, matching variables and declarations, that context-free languages cannot do. But these can be done by simple tables. But there are some other features of context-free languages that cannot be represented by programming languages, cannot be represented as context-free. And so one reason that context-free is important to study context-free languages is for parsing and compiling, because parsing and compiling makes use of techniques from context-free languages. To some extent, it constructs pushdown automata. So it helps you to understand parsing and compiling if you understand context-free languages. And regular languages turn out to be useful in this, because context-free languages, the way you represent them, can be made more flexible, more powerful using regular expressions. So you'll see that what we studied already does have some applications to context-free languages. Let's see. Pushdown automata are more powerful than finite automata. There is a pushdown automata, a very simple one, that recognizes the language A to the end, B to the end, such that n is greater than or equal to 0, which cannot be represented by finite automata, which we proved. But there is also some languages that cannot be represented by pushdown automata, so we will prove a sort of another pumping theorem for context-free languages, similar to what we did for finite automata. Show that certain languages cannot be recognized by pushdown automata. And then we'll talk about Turing machines which can recognize those languages. But there are some languages that Turing machines cannot recognize, and so we have another theorem that will give us languages that Turing machines cannot recognize. Turing machines have an infinite amount of memory, but it can be accessed in an arbitrary manner. They can move back and forth through the memory and not be erased. So this has tremendous applications. It's just an enormous increase in computing power Turing machines have over pushdown automata. Okay, so let's give an example. I don't know how many of you have studied foreign languages, but sometimes it's hard to understand your own language until you study foreign language. But anyway, you probably all had grammar as parts of speech to some extent. I don't know if they're still teaching that. I don't know if people still diagram sentences. But. So let's just consider a restricted subset of English with the following parts of speech. So we'll say, it's going to be very, you know, stripped down grammar. Sentence, subject, predicate, verb, object, article, and noun. So S-U-P-V-O-A-N. These are going to represent these parts of speech. And we're going to somehow give the minimal grammar in terms of these parts of speech. So we're going to write something like this. S-A-R-U-P, that's say, a sentence. One possible form for a sentence is a subject followed by a predicate. So S is a sentence, U is a subject, P is a predicate, and then a period at the end of the sentence. Now there may be other things that could be sentences too, so you could have other rules like this. But this is how we will represent the grammar. Instead of diagramming the sentences, we will represent it by these kinds of rules with arrows. And the capital letters will represent parts of speech. So this is called a rule that S goes to UP. That's the inner collection of rules. It's called a grammar. So we might have a simple grammar for a small subset of English like this. S goes to UP. It says that a sentence can be a subject followed by a predicate followed by a period. Subject can be an article followed by a noun. Articles are things like B and A. A predicate can be a verb followed by an object. An object can be an article followed by a noun. An article can be an A when we're going to put a space in there. Just for completeness, or the. A noun can be ball, boy, dog, pumpkin. Verb can be hit through eight. Noun can be girl. Subject can be he, she, it. Object can be him, her, it. So we have, this is our simple grammar. So you can make sentences just by putting them together. Now the uppercase letters are called non-terminals and corresponding parts of speech. So this is S-U-P, the capital letters. But these things are lowercase. They correspond to particular words or strings. These are called terminals. These lower, these through and A and so on. These actually appear in a sentence. So you start, the way you get sentences, you start with a start symbol, which is S in this case, and then you just keep replacing. You replace S by U, period, or whatever you want to, and then replace U with something. Keep replacing until you've gotten rid of all the non-terminals. And then if you have a string of terminals, that's a sentence. You know, that's a string in the grammar. So here's an example derivation. Now we use this arrow to indicate that you're replacing the left-hand side of the rule by the right-hand side of the rule. So we start with S goes to UP period. That's because I had a rule up here. It says S arrow UP. That means I can replace this by this. And then UP goes to ANP because I'm replacing the U by AN. And that's because I have a rule up here that has U goes to AN, you see. So it's a pretty simple one. And then ANP, A gets replaced by the, and that's because I have this rule. A goes to the, you see this one here. And I'll just keep doing that, replacing left-hand sides of these rules by the right-hand sides. So I get S goes to UP period, ANP period, the, N, D, period, the boy, P, period, the boy, verb, object, period, the boy hit, object, the boy hit, A, N, the boy hit, A, N, the boy hit a ball, period. Well, the period is, has a space in the ball. I mean, it's not perfect because there's a space after the ball. But you can generate sentences this way, and you can generate quite a few reasonable ones. The boy threw the rock, the ball hit it. I mean, that's okay. But then you can generate some silly sentences like a pumpkin ate the ball or a ball threw a pumpkin. So, but even though they're silly, I think we still recognize that they're sentences, even if they're silly sentences. They might appear in a children's book. So, is certainly not a complete model of English grammar. It needs a model of grammar, and this is really hard. We really haven't figured out. You know, AI is making all this spectacular progress, but we really a lot of things that are really pretty simple that the computers can't figure out how to do, such as how to figure out what sense is mean. How common sense reasoning usually is slow and not doing. So all this stuff in newspapers, it is true. AI is becoming very powerful, and it is something we have to think about controlling the dangers of it. In other areas, computers are just really very primitive and they don't really perform very well. So you need to add some information about semantics, and it's just not clear how to do that. We just, as we grow up, we just have an enormous amount of information. You know, the buildings are bigger than people, and all kinds of stuff, you know. And people's heads are above their feet, usually when they're standing. All this stuff we know, we just sort of take for granted. And cheese up on the stuff unless you tell them one by one. And then that doesn't seem quite right. So how does information get in our mind? We don't know that. But anyway, context-free grammars are important, context-free languages, because even if we can't understand semantics very well, it's certainly true that we do organize language by context-free grammars, largely. So in general, a context-free grammar, so the general form of remember, finite automata are five tuples. So grammar is a four tuple, where V is a set of variables, sigma is an alphabet of terminal symbols, R is a set of rules, and S is a start symbol. Now we've seen the start symbol, it's like a sentence, and the rules we've seen, we haven't really quite specified V and sigma yet, in general. So V is a set of variables. This includes sort of something like the parts of speech together with the terminal symbols. The elements of V minus sigma are called non-terminals. These are like the parts of speech. So here's an example of grammar. We said V, sigma, R, S, where V is S, A, B. S is the non-terminal, two terminals. Sigma is A, B, two terminals. And R has the rules, S goes to A, S, B, and S goes to E. Now here's this empty string again. Now non-terminals, as a custom, they're typically represented by capital letters, and terminals by lowercase letters. Are those the exams? All right, well, maybe we should break this off so you can all come up and get your exam, and we'll continue with context-free.